Welcome to Zoo Tours,
the channel that brings the zoo
right to you. On this episode, we are back at Lowry Park for ZooTampa's Florida Wildlife Center. It opened in 1990, just 2 years after what the zoo calls their rejuvenation and reopening. It's one of my all-time favorite realms, and hopefully you'll see why. We've talked about how exhibits with local wildlife are often overlooked, but Florida avoids this cliche. This is a favorite not necessarily because of the quality, but its incredible variety, from big, medium, to tiny. There's over 85 animals from the swamps, forests, and tropical waters to represent Florida's significant biodiversity. Now before we begin, if you're new here, please hit those like and subscribe buttons and the bell icon to officially join our tours. Since we are looking at ZooTampa in order, here's just a quick recap. It does start with the walk-through aviary, filled with some of the world's most colorful and vibrant birds. And it follows with the Asian Gardens, home to some of the continent's rarest and endangered tropical animals. This was our first tour, and I highly recommend you check it out, and you can do so by clicking on that card above. Now after passing Gronk and the other Indian rhinos, Florida officially begins. In the corner by the Zoo Ventures Theater is a Tomistosa, aka the false gharial. Because they do heavily resemble a true gharial, this vulnerable crocodilian can grow over 15 feet and weigh 500 pounds. But the funny thing about our first animal, they're actually not from Florida and naturally live thousands of miles away in Southeast Asia. And speaking of not being from around here, next up on the tour are red wolves, one of America's most endangered animals. But they're not in this area because something needed to fill this exhibit. But Florida in the Southeast US was part of their historic range before nearly being driven to extinction. And today there's only about 25 wild red wolves that can be found in North Carolina. The silver lining is there are still several hundred captive breeding and introduction programs across the country. At this point, a long boardwalk takes you through the main entrance, and I recommend you go all the way towards the Key West deck, and there you'll get really close to their brown pelicans. They can be found on both coasts of North and South America. ZooTampa serves as a sanctuary to six rescues that can no longer fly due to permanent wing injuries they sustained in the wild. These six also live with, well, you'll see. After a little bit of backtracking, you used to be able to enter the Stingray Bay, a 16,000 gallon touch pool that was added in 2001. From every part of the ledge, visitors used to be able to pet and feed cow nose, southern and Atlantic stingrays. And if you're wondering why I keep using past tense, well, that's because, go to the description below to find out. So as far as I know, the only animals around here are a couple of southern bald eagles, which yes, are also rescues. You'll quickly notice that's sort of one of Florida's many themes. Now it's time to head inside. First thing that you'll see is a long hallway with an impressive collection of nearly 50 local and invasive reptiles, fish, invertebrates, and more. It starts with a greater siren, an eel-like amphibian. As for the reptiles, there's garter snakes, dusky pygmy rattlesnakes that are so small they could fit in the palm of your hand. Below is the very venomous cottonmouth and the yellow rat snake of the Everglades. And right after them, there are three dark identical cubes for timber rattlesnakes, an albino eastern diamondback, and a Fiji banded iguana. The other side has another good set of smaller terrariums, but I only saw spotted turtles and a burrowed gopher tortoise. From the coastal waters, look for the look-down fish, honeycomb moray eel, and my personal favorite, the brown-banded bamboo shark. Native to the Indo-Pacific waters is the red lionfish. They are now well-established along America's east coast and the Gulf of Mexico. And as cool as the lionfish is, invasive species can be a problem. They can add to the competition for natural resources that are really meant for native species. The last tanks have burrfish, a member of the porcupine fish, and dwarf seahorses. Their max length is just 2 inches, and they're not even the smallest seahorse. But they are the world's slowest fish, clocking in at a speedy 5 feet per hour. On the right side of the hallway, there's a bigger tank for an alligator snapping turtle. The estuary tank has porkfish, sheep's heads, and a few more that you can read below. And speaking of invasive animals, say hi to Sandwich the Cuban iguana. No, I'm not saying his species is invasive, I'm saying that he is. Sandwich is a stowaway and made his way to Florida from Guantanamo Bay on a boat, apparently all on his own. At the building's end is one of Florida's many highlights, the Manatee Mangrove, a recovery home for some of the zoo's many patients. There are 2 shallow pools combined for 200,000 gallons. Each one has multiple underwater windows, and you can even go above the surface for a close, clear, panoramic look at everything from the deck. This exhibit spotlight obviously shines on their Florida manatees. Some of you may know them as the sea cow. And where did they get that name? They're both often slow, and I mean slow in nature. Although I think manatees definitely better fit this behavior over cows. The other reason is because of the way they eat. Manatees will graze, apparently on each other and on the seafloor, for up to 8 hours a day, sometimes eating up to 100 pounds of seagrass and other aquatic plants off the ocean floor. The Florida manatee, a subspecies of the West Indian manatee, is endangered. They're a protected species, but that doesn't stop pollution, habitat loss, cold stress, and boat strikes. Fortunately, the zoo is here to help. Since 1991, ZooTampa has treated over 500 sick or injured manatees, over half of which were returned to their native waters. Some live here, and others are closely examined in the care center's 16,000 gallon med pools. So if you are from around here and see a manatee in trouble, be sure to call this number. If you somehow couldn't tell, they are not alone. There's Fly River, Yellow Spotted, and Giant Amazon River Turtles. They like to steal some of the manatees' food and their attention, but evidently there's no hard feelings between the two. Floating above them are the pelicans we saw earlier, with hooded mergansers and ruddy ducks, which I'm going to assume are rescues as well. And it's not just the manatees and birds. The zoo also gives a helping hand to river otters. More specifically, Quigley. He was found orphaned at just a few weeks old with injuries to his tail. He was deemed unreleasable and found his way to Tampa. And it didn't take long for him to make friends with the zoo's other longtime resident. The land portion of Quigley and Harriet's habitat is elevated to your eyeline, but it does have a stream that falls into not one, but 2 deeper pools. Past the otters and the manatee viewing deck is a large swamp. According to the zoo's Twitter, there's an alligator snapping turtle, but I did manage to spot a moorhen that I'm going to assume is wild, and no Florida exhibit is really complete without the American alligator. They're about as iconic to the South as far as animals go, but that wasn't always the case. After a good 40 million year run of being on Earth, they were also nearly hunted to extinction by the 1950s. After gaining protection from the Endangered Species Act, it only took 3 decades for the gator to fully recover. Now 5 million American alligators spread across the Southeast US. Over 1 million live in Florida alone. Nearby are a few small aviaries, first for a snowy egret. The second one across from them has great horned owls, and connected to that is Florida's larger main aviary for black-bellied whistling ducks, black-necked stilts, roseate spoonbills, and more. They all have the pleasure of watching a rare gem that lives across from them. The Florida panther. Looks like your usual mountain lion, but to some, they're one of America's rarest animals. For over a century, they were thought to be their own cougar subspecies. After a genetic analysis, they were reclassified as the North American cougar we're all familiar with. But many zoos and even several wildlife agencies still refer to them as a separate subspecies. Regardless, the Florida panther is still very unique. Obviously, as their name says, you can only find them scattered throughout the state, which means they are part of the only mountain lion population east of the Mississippi, with numbers reporting as high as 250 individuals. And that's why people believe they should remain an endangered subspecies, even though the North American cougar is not. ZooTampa has rehabilitated and released several of these cats back into the wild. Right now, they're home to three, so that means they had to rotate with one enclosure. But that's about to change. The zoo is reworking this back half of Florida, and by 2022, there will be three spaces for the panthers. And you can check out some of the renderings in the description below. Next is their not-so-nosy, but noisy neighbors, the American flamingo. Once a welcomed resident, they again were almost hunted out of Florida nearly a century ago, and biologists ever since have seen them as invasive. But thanks to an increasing population, there are people out there working to reverse that and consider the American flamingo a Florida resident once again. Now, in terms of animal types, this is the most diverse exhibit I've ever seen. There was a sandhill crane, three kinds of box turtles, and a gopher tortoise on the move, but none of them could quite keep up with the striped skunks, one of North America's most common animal, and I never thought we'd run into one, let alone a whole family. In 2019, Mother Mia gave birth to seven kits that the zoo says haven't stopped moving since they were able to crawl. The zoo also says they're very curious, but don't like surprises, if you know what I mean. Striped skunks have scent glands near the tail that contain half an ounce of something unbearable that we've probably all smelled at least once in our lives. And if they feel threatened enough, they can shoot this pungent spray and hit their target from 15 feet away. But they will only use this defensive reaction as a last resort. Right in front of them are two more smaller flight cages for eastern screech owls and barred owls. And you guessed it, they are also rescues. After the animals in need, another boardwalk begins. This long, narrow swamp has another snapping turtle and a few Florida black bears. Yep, bears do live around here, just not as much as they used to. They now occupy only about 20% of their historic range, which used to stretch out of Florida, where they were more commonly found in Georgia and Alabama. So there are ongoing efforts to officially mark the Florida black bear down as a threatened subspecies. With the panther, the bears are also getting somewhat of an upgrade to their home as well next year. On the other side of the boardwalk, look out for more sandhill cranes. I don't know much about the backstories of these two, but I do know they live in the former Red Wolf enclosure, and they are also the last animals on this tour. So that's two major ZooTampa sections down, just three more to go. Let me know what you thought of the Florida Wildlife Center, and if this video made you want to come down and make a visit yourself. If you can, be sure to follow me on my new Instagram account and stop by the Zoo Crew gift shop on your way out. I recommend the fan favorite Save the Manatees tea, because proceeds go towards the Save the Manatee Club. So thank you all for watching, and see if you can answer this episode's trivia question.